Welcome to the Information Security Forum podcast. I'm your host, Tavia Gilbert, and this podcast is the second in a series of three episodes featuring ISF Managing Director Steve Durbin speaking with Richard Guida, Managing Director of Guida Technology Associates. Last time, we spoke with Rich about the challenges of implementing data security at large corporations. Today, we talk data security and the Internet of Things.
Moving on slightly, you know, we're beginning to talk about some emerging technologies that are out there, some of the ways in which technology is changing people's lives. Do you believe we're safer? Are we more secure because of the way in which technology is changing? And of course, because of the increased sophistication, I guess, of the layperson or the person using that technology, is that making us more secure, do you think, or is it having the opposite kind of effect?
Sadly, I think it's the opposite. And this is not to denigrate or to demean the many very noble efforts of a lot of vendors to build in security into their products. The trouble is what I alluded to earlier. Most products, the impetus is to bring things to market quickly, particularly in the IoT space, the Internet of Things space. And bringing things to market quickly almost always denigrates security. The same thing is true in the SCADA environment, you know, supervisory control and data acquisition, the devices and the programmable logic controllers, et cetera, that are put into plants. If you spend a lot of time, as I know you have, in the SCADA space, it is remarkable just how non-secure those spaces are. Mm-hmm. They used to be very secure because, as I said earlier, they were isolated. They weren't connected to the Internet. You connect these things to the Internet, to these networks to the Internet, and suddenly you have the ability to control devices that are running, power plants, water treatment plants, et cetera, and can destroy the physical hardware, can basically bring networks, bring grids crashing down. So my concern there is, honestly, that a lot of the devices that are being built into those environments, which are aimed at like the smart grid, every time I see a commercial on the smart grid, I apologize, but I almost want to just hold my nose. The smart grid is going to make things more energy efficient, all that. Yes, it's a good thing, except for the fact that it's opening up massive vulnerabilities that could easily be exploited by not just nation states that want to do harm to the United States, but even by criminals who may want to hold a grid hostage, you know, until they are paid a couple million dollars. So criminal organizations, the nature of the threat changes when these things get connected to the Internet. So my point in saying all that is just that I think that as a whole, society as a whole is getting less secure, not more secure, as we do all these things. Now, do I think that means that we're headed to Armageddon or to a situation where where we shouldn't be doing that stuff? No. I think what it means is there has to be, and this is a bad word these days, but there needs to be appropriate government regulation of devices that are providing public services. And an example of that is the grids, things like that. It needs to be appropriate regulation to protect those against the kinds of attacks that exist even today and are going to get worse with time. Now, what about devices owned by individuals? Here, the calculus is a bit different. I would agree with you, certainly, that I think that some of the devices that have more recently been brought to market do appear to have much better security built into them than older devices do. The trouble that I see is that these devices, first of all, they're not yet ubiquitous. We still have a lot of older devices in the environment which are pretty profoundly corrupted or corruptible. And the newer devices have only been in the marketplace for brief periods. They have not yet, it has not yet been established just how secure they really are. The iPhone with the facial recognition has a lot of promise. That has a lot of promise as to what it can offer in terms of authentication of the user. But I have not, I want to make it pass judgment on that, make a judgment on that a couple years from now after we see how successful the university researchers are in thwarting the facial recognition software on that device, just as, for example, people were very successful at thwarting fingerprint scanners, using, paste on their, rice paste. There was a Japanese physicist who basically, could do that just with homegrown stuff, didn't have to use any NSA scale things. So that's my big worry about that. Unfortunately, time has to pass to make a good judgment, but I am hopeful for the consumer devices that things will get a bit better, except for, again, the consumer devices that are Internet of Things devices. Those I continue to be extremely worried about. The Nest thermometer, there was on Amazon, there was a coffee maker where you could buy it, that and it would connect to the internet, so you could control it over the internet. This is a coffee pot that has to connect to the internet. So that is an example of an IoT device that I just ask myself, why? Well, because it's jazzy and you can make a few extra dollars selling it. Yeah, at the same time, you now create an opportunity for a botnet to go absorb it. So it's just that kind of mindlessness that worries me.
Yeah, and I agree. I've had many a conversation with manufacturers of those devices, really trying to understand the benefit to me as a consumer, as the user. I get the benefit to the manufacturer. I get that. They now know how much coffee I'm consuming. They now know what my habits are. And by the way, if it's hacked, so does everybody else. And therein lies the rub. So I struggle in that space. I think your point about smart grids and the way in which critical infrastructure has evolved as well is a very good one. I mean, it used to be that the perspective was if you could prevent people from getting into the power plant, then you were safe. And so what we saw, of course, was very strong physical security on the outside. But of course, that has now changed. And the systems that are in place are just so very sophisticated. It's very difficult to play catch up, I guess, within the sort of period of time that we're talking about. And of course, that opens up vulnerabilities to nation states and cyber criminals, as you've pointed out. So how do you really see then the balance shifting or changing, perhaps? Because we've got technology that is running ahead at a pace. We already have, you know, fully connected cars, autonomous vehicles. We already have the ability to remotely manage our homes. How do you see all of that developing in the future with the speed or the pace of, I guess, people's awareness and then following on from that, their concern around being able to manage the security of those sorts of things so that actually these do become the benefits that Silicon Valley and other places are really pushing towards, because there is a balance, isn't there?
No, I think that's, again, very eloquently put, and I concur completely. There's a model for cloud services that you're very familiar with, the CASB model, you know, the cloud access security brokers. If I were, you know, a betting person, which being a nuclear engineer, I don't bet, okay, but if I were a betting person, here's what I would bet on and what I'm hoping for, because I want my home to be automated. I want all those features, you know, to be there, but I don't want to have to manage, you know, 50 different devices on my home network individually. My hope is that there will be companies that will emerge that offer kind of a cloud access security broker, in this case, a home automation device security broker role. So the idea is you would go through that broker with strong authentication, two-factor authentication, VPN in from your laptop, you know, wherever you might be. But you would go to that broker, and from that broker would then manage for you the many devices that are in your home that provide home automation services or other things. Now, there is always a danger when you have a spigot like that, right? If the cloud access security broker itself gets compromised, you are thoroughly screwed, okay, which is not a good thing. But if that model works, you know, if that cloud access security broker can be relied upon to be reasonably secure, then strong authentication to that and using them in essence to manage the security of your devices can provide a degree of resilience and a degree of protection against individual devices being picked off hither and yon. And that managing the devices, I'm talking about everything from, you know, patching them to monitoring their behaviors. One of the things with SCADA systems, again, I'm sure you're well aware of this, but with SCADA systems, the move towards improved security in part is watching the behavior of the sensors. So if, for example, one sensor, you know, says it's 50 degrees and another sensor says it's 90 degrees and they're in adjoining rooms, it's probably one of those sensors is either defective or something is going wrong, okay? So you look at the behavioral analytics, so to speak, with respect to what the sensors are telling you or what the devices are telling you. And the same thing in the case of a home, in my view, in the case of home automation. If your air conditioning is on, you know, the sensor says it's on, and temperature in your house is 95 degrees, either the air conditioner's failed or somebody's tricked the system into turning your heat on instead of the air conditioner, okay? So you can look for anomalies like that across multiple sensors and across multiple platforms. When I say you can, it's not clear that you as an individual homeowner could, but your CASB, your cloud access security broker can be looking for those kinds of things, which is no different than what an SIEM, you know, security information event monitoring system, intrusion detection system, intrusion prevention system. These are all things that exist today, of course, in enterprises. And then they're looking for similar kinds of anomalies on your network, in your applications, you know, in on your servers, looking for the same sorts of things, except they're focused on the network and the apps, okay, either host intrusion or network intrusion. I'm talking about abstracting that instead to all of your home devices that have automation. So that's my hope as to how some improvement can be achieved in the area of security. And the same thing with a cloud access environment, as you're well aware, cloud access security broker, they have a picture on how the threat's changing as well. They'll know if a whole bunch of homes are being attacked and therefore they are seeing behaviors in your home that match behaviors they're observing in all the automated devices on these other homes too. They're not looking at you in isolation, just like a CASB looks at all of its clients. So, you know, that's that centralized kind of security function, there are vulnerabilities it creates and there are downsides to that, but there are big upsides as well. And for the average homeowner, I hope that's the way we'll go.
Mm-hmm. And I think that really, for me anyway, it opens up one of the most exciting elements of the kind of industry that we're in, right? Because for so long, security has always been about preventing people from doing things. And now what we're beginning to talk about is the need perhaps to have, you know, consolidation of skills, expertise to provide something that actually goes far beyond what any individual or indeed any one organization might be able to do. And that I think is, you know, a good thing. I think both for the industry and indeed for the opportunities, both commercially and otherwise, that it presents to people, you know, entering the workspace and indeed those that are already there.
That was the second part of our three-part conversation with Rich Guida, Managing Director of Guida Technology Associates. Be sure to listen for the final installment in our three-part series of interviews with Rich, in which we'll be talking about integrating security into the product development process and the importance of security for laypeople. And of course, you can hear more conversations with Steve Durbin at securityforum.org.